Hi everyone, hope you are all doing good. Stay home, stay safe. I am Vijay, assistant professor in the Department of Civil Engineering from SRM Institute of Science and Technology. In this particular lecture session, we are going to discuss about the disaster management and different mitigation techniques. Disasters affects almost every part of the world. With better planning, preparedness, awareness and mitigation measurements, of course, we can significantly reduce the impact of any disaster. So according to the World Bank report, so every year almost 2% of GDP is getting reduced or getting lost because of disasters that India is frequently facing. So when this disaster mitigation or management principles may be common to the entire world, still it depends upon every individual nations. We do formulate own acts and policies. So why? Because every nation have their own geophysical or geopolitical strategies. How can we actually define a disaster? So the term disaster means calamity or great misfortune. The World Health Organization in the year of 1990 gave a theme: should disaster strike, be prepared. The methyl isocyanate that was leaked in Bhopal was one of the greatest man-made disaster in the world. These are the different components that we are actually discussing. For example, the terms of disaster, when was the world has actually come to recognize that we should need a different policies to fight the disasters, and the previous experiences, then governmental organizations, of course, all the federal agencies or government agencies do have double the load during the disasters. The paramilitary forces, police, everyone has to make sure that the disasters are mitigated and the victims are properly responded. And then the multidimensional relief efforts and multi-institutional approaches needed for management of the disaster. To be precise, a sudden, adverse or unfortunate extreme events, or in fact series of events which seriously disrupts the normal activities, can be termed as disaster. It can be a natural or even a man-made. Of course, a disaster is an event located in time and space which produces the conditions whereby the continuity of the structure and process of social units becomes problematic, and overwhelming ecological disruptions occurring on a scale sufficient to require outside assistance. The United Nations have given a separate definition for the disaster, which can be followed by almost every nation. So the United Nations defines it as a serious disruption of the functioning of a community or a society, causing widespread human, material, economic and environmental losses which exceed the ability of the affected community, society, to cope using its own resources. Coming to the elements of a risk, when I mean a disaster, it's all about the risk. The product of the hazard and vulnerability community is what is the risk. So for example, you take a national highway in which a human is crossing. So the hazards are the fast moving vehicles. So who is vulnerable there? The human who is crossing the road. So what is the risk value? Maybe hit by the car. So that's called as the accident. So the product of hazard and vulnerability is what is risk. So now, the main components of disasters are widely classified into two different categories: the natural and man-made. So when you take natural can be further subclassified as geological, hydrological or climatical, environmental or biological. So whereas in the case of man-made, it is again can be subclassified as chemical or nuclear and industrial accidents or any other accident that causes due to the negligence. When I mean vulnerability, so it again have different categories such as economic vulnerability, physical vulnerability, social vulnerability and environmental vulnerability. Take physical vulnerability. So the one which analyze impacts of events on assets such as building infrastructure, agriculture or whatever it is. The social vulnerability is nothing but estimating the impacts of events on highly vulnerable groups such as the poor, coping capacity, status of institutional structures designed to help coping, creation of awareness of risk, etc. Economical vulnerability, of course, the potential impact on businesses and its interruption and followed by the secondary effects. Well, the environmental vulnerability is all about the degraded environmental quality limits the natural resilience to hazard effects and reduces environmental buffering of effects. The effects of disaster can be from anywhere, just from an injury or a simple minor loss to a death, or even sometimes the economy itself will crash during any disaster. The best example is the current COVID-19, so where the economic lockdown is being experienced by all the nations around the globe. So while effects of disasters have deaths, severe injuries requiring intensive care, increased communicable diseases, I am not talking about only the COVID-19, even during in the case of earthquake or tsunami. Okay, the food scarcity, population displacement, initial reaction among the survivors is shock, the psychological aspects, the exposure to climate, food crops may get damaged. So these are the widespread effects of the disaster. Clearly, the scope of disaster management must be well equipped with an applied science which seeks by the systematic observation and analysis of disasters to improve measures relating to prevention, mitigation, preparedness, emergency response and recovery. So well, the disaster management is not merely the extension of emergency services or casualty, but something more. The stages of disaster management. So it starts from the warning stage. For example, a meteorological organization or seismological observatory, okay, or any other observatory gives a warning. For example, in case of cyclone, a 48 hours warning will be released. In case of flood, a week long bulletins will be released. Then the stage of impact, time during which disaster actually strikes. So initially warning, then actual time period. Next, the stage of rescue operations. It should not take more than 2 to 3 days to finish off any rescue operations. So that itself will tell the intensity of a disaster. The stage of health and medical services that is being deployed, especially to prevent any communicable diseases. So next, the rehabilitation stage. So people who were lost, people who lost their own belongings, their relatives or friends in the disaster will be in shock. Even the businessmen who were experienced a huge loss due to the disaster. So the psychological aspects, that particular dealings should also be considered. So these are the different stages that has to be implemented in any disaster management policy. So starting from the observation and releasing of warning, then the governance during the exact time of disaster, the stage of rescue operations, then stage of health and medical setup that a nation has, then rehabilitation stage. We do have a disaster management framework in India, which actually relies to make disaster management an integral part of national development agenda, to promote awareness and education in disaster management, to promote human resource development and disaster management, to develop institutional frameworks at national level and state level for mainstreaming the disaster management units, to establish multi-hazard preparedness, mitigation and preparedness plans at all levels. This includes the prevention policies also, to enhance capacities at levels for multi-hazard preparedness and response. So when the disaster management framework includes the DM Act 2005, NDMA, NIDM and NDRF. So the Prime Minister stands as the chief for the disaster management units. So we do have National Disaster Response Force. So here for Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andaman and Lakshadweep, we have NDRF 4th Battalion at Arakkonam. And coming to the legal institutional framework based upon the Disaster Management Act 2005, the Ministry of Home Affairs will act as the nodal ministry. So in case of any disaster, so well, we all might be aware. So even during this COVID-19, it was MHA that continuously gives different updates upon the restrictions, lockdown, or what are the procurements that are being placed. Now the incident response team, where the chief secretary or district magistrate will be the head of the SDME units. So that's the state level IRT, incident response team, and the district level IRTs. So the district collector will take the responsibility. So sub-divisional level and at block level. Well, the coordination of response starts from BDO, the block development officer, or the Tahsildar. So they will have the direct links with the police or junior executives or any governmental operations strategies. So from the Tahsildar, they will get communicated to the district collector, that is the district administration, and finally to the state level EOC. At the state level EOC, the chief secretary will handle the particular situations, and the air nodal officer. So well, the 12 key features that NDMA introduced in the act as well as in the policy is about management by objectives. Number 2, unity of command and chain of command. Number 3, transfer of command. 4, organizational flexibility. 5, span of control. Number 6, area command. Number 7, unified command. Number 8, common terminology. Number 9, accountability. Number 10, integrated communications. Number 11, resource management. And number 12, incident action plan. You have different set of agencies that works on disasters. You take cyclones, that's IMD. For tsunami, Indian National Center for Oceanic Information Services, we call it as INCOIS. And for floods, Central Water Commission, landslides, Geological Survey of India, avalanche, snow and avalanche study establishment by DRDO, Ministry of Defense, and heat and cold waves, again, it's IMD. So starting from the intervention, going through the reconditioning process, and then analysis, reconstruction, prevention, preparation, it's fine. So from limiting extents of the damage to reducing the vulnerability, this is perfectly can be possible only when we learn from the past history, as well as the strategies has to be made in such a way that it can be modified for each and every state in India. For example, we take Tamil Nadu, which is highly prone to cyclonic storms. So in that scenario, the policies can or the units can be trained exclusively focusing on the cyclones, on the subsequent rescue operations. Whereas in this we are completing, and from the next sessions we will get into the different policies of disaster management and mitigation. So thank you for watching this video. So you can also send your comments or suggestions through email or any of the social media platforms. Subscribe. Thank you.